So good morning, I'm Jean-Claude Kieffer, and it's a real pleasure today to introduce Professor Victor Malka. Professor Malka est directeur de recherche au laboratoire d'optique appliquée au CNRS et à l'École polytechnique de Paris. And he also professor at the Weizmann Institute of Science in Israel. Professor Malka has been working in relativistic laser-matter interaction for many years, and he did a fantastic breakthrough by discovering how you can accelerate electrons using small-scale, relatively small-scale laser system. And he received several international prizes for this achievement. So please welcome Professor Malka.
Thank you, Jean-Claude, for this very nice introduction. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here to attend this conference, to attend the ESAC committee, and I've been very impressed by the quality of the presentation of the result and also by the discussion that I have with a student. So I'm going to discuss about a new concept that works today, and this concept is about a new approach to accelerate particles, and it relies on the manipulation of relativistic electrons with an electromagnetic wave that is a laser pulse. So in this picture, it's a simulation that shows how you can create this accelerating structure with a laser pulse and how you can control the injection of electrons in order to provide high quality electron beam. So this is the outline of my presentation. I will start with a short introduction in which I will explain the motivation of our approach. Then after, I will introduce three concepts that we demonstrated recently. And then after, I will discuss about the application before to conclude. So the first message regarding the development of accelerator is that physicists have developed accelerator to answer to fundamental questions. These questions are about what are the element constituent of matter, what are the fundamental interactions, what is the dark matter, what is the dark energy, and so on. This is why, since about 120 years, we are developing accelerator. And the first machine was a cathodic tube discovered by Joseph Thomson, which has been used in order to study the hydrogen structure. Then after, we have to wait about 20, 30 years in order to have the first cyclotron machine that was discovered by Ernest Lawrence. With this machine, he has produced ions at few tenths of keV that has been used in order to produce artificial radioisotope. He got a Nobel Prize with this discovery, and the cost of this machine was about $25 at this time. So this is why probably one of the cheapest Nobel Prize with the discovery of graphene in experimental science, I have to precise. Then it's very interesting to look at the story of this guy because he was one of the main artisans of the project called Manhattan Project. So it was the beginning of what we call the big science. And this is important because later on, you have to develop a big machine and you have to structure the accelerator community. So by doing this, it has been possible to develop machines that are bigger and bigger and are producing particles in the hundreds of MeV, in the GeV, in the hundreds of GeV, and now in the TeV level, which is the record today at the LHC, Large Hadron Collider, the machine that has been used in order to demonstrate the existence of the Higgs boson, which was the last particle to conclude and to validate the standard model. So these machines are very impressive. They are very robust, very reliable, and they produce particles not only at very high energy, but with a high brightness. So this is the first message. It's a curiosity-driven approach that makes this research. The second message is the following. Accelerators are used in our common life. And this is not necessarily known by everybody here, but there is a lot of application on the use of accelerator. So in this table, the first column, you can see the different application for medical purpose, for example, for cancer therapy or for imaging with PET, positron emission tomography, for security. These are represented here. In the second column, you can see the number of machines that have been sold. And then after you have the average number of machines that are sold every year. And in the last column, this is the average price for each of these machines. And the number that you have to keep in mind is the market, which is about a few billion of dollars a year. So this is a very impressive number. And we have the opportunity to see how we can complement this different application with our approach based on laser. So all these machines rely on what we call a metallic cavity, a radio frequency cavity. And within this cavity, you can generate an electric field, but the value of the electric field is limited to few tens of megavolt per meters. And if you overcome this limit, you break your cavity and you have to replace it. So if you want to have a particle with high energy, because the field is limited, you have to increase the length. It means that you need to increase the cost of the machine. So this is a picture or draw of the LHC. It's a circular accelerator, which is about 27 kilometer length. So it's about the peripheric road in Paris, which is about 31 kilometers. So this gives you an idea of the size of the machine, and you have to realize that this accelerator is about 80 meters underground. So we know, and this is a limitation, and we are discussing with CERN about the future, and there will be LHC, a compact linear international collider, which will be a linear collider, which will have a few tens of kilometers. And this will be probably the last machine that is built on this radio frequency technique. So we have to find a solution, and the solution is probably to use this medium, which is the plasma medium. So a plasma medium, if you are not familiar with, is a medium in which you have free electrons and ions. Electrons are free. It means that you can the medium can sustain an electric field without any limitation for the amplitude of the electric field. So in a plasma medium, the electrons oscillate around the ions, okay, because they are free. And the ions are heavy, so during the time scale of interest, we consider they do not move. So if you see a plasma, the resulting electric field is equal to zero because the electrons oscillate a different direction. If you want to generate an electric field, what you have to do is to move all the electrons together in phase in a coherent way. It means that you need to create what we call a plasma wave. So this is a plasma wave in which we have the ions here in red and the electron in green. And when you do this, you move all the electrons together. I hope it will work. Yeah. You see, at this moment of time, you have more electrons here than here. It means that you have separated a lot of electrons from the ions. It means that you have generated an electric field. This electric field is an oscillating electric field, and you have to use it during a time scale that is very short. So because you move all the electrons together, you sum up the component of the electric field, and you are able to have a very bright, very intense electric field. How we do that? The idea has been proposed in 1979 by Tajima and Dawson, and rely on the use of a short pulse laser. When you focus short pulse laser on a gas target, the gas is immediately ionized, and there is a force that we call a ponderomotive force that will push out the electrons from high intensity region to low intensity region. So the laser will push out the electrons, the ions are fixed, so they call back the electrons, and then the electrons oscillate. So this is a picture in which you can see the isodensity of the perturbation, and here you can see the related electric field. So it's similar to a boat on the lake that creates a wave, okay? So in this scheme, the electric field that you can achieve can reach a value of about 1 gigavolt per meter. So this is 10 times greater than what you can have today, but nevertheless, you need to have 1 meter in order to reach 1 GeV. What is important to realize is that you need to have a short pulse laser in order to satisfy what we call a resonance condition. And there is a quantity that is called the laser plasma wavelength. It's the distance between the two arches here. And this distance scales with 1/1 the electron density. It means if you go to higher density, the distance between the arch will be small, and at the same time, the amplitude of the electric field will be large. So it's important to have this quantity in memory. In 2002, we discovered a new regime in this publication in Science 2002 that is called the nonlinear regime. In this nonlinear regime, we are able to produce hundreds of gigavolt per meters, which is 4 orders of magnitude greater than what you can achieve in a quadrio frequency cavity. So this is a simulation with the ISO density representation in which you have the laser, you have the coherent structure here of the plasma wave, and this is about 100 micron. And the distance here, it's about 10 micron. It's about the length of the plasma, of the laser pulse. On the left part here, you can see the radio frequency cavity, the metallic cavity, which is about 1 meter length and distance. And over this distance, you can have a similar gain than here in 100 micron. So the difficulty that we have to do, the challenge that we have to face 15 years ago, was first to convince that it will be possible with a laser to create a coherent motion of electrons, and then after to find a way to trap electrons in a very well-defined position. So this is what I am going to explain you now. So if you make a zoom on the first part of the accelerating structure of the arch, you have the laser pulse here. And in this bubble region, you have 2 parts. In green, you have the accelerating part, and in red, you have the decelerating part. This is the longitudinal electric field component. And if you look at the transverse electric field component, you can see that you have also very intense laser, very intense field that can be used in order to reduce the divergence of the electron beam, or even better, to wiggle the electron to produce X-ray. So this is a movie in which you can see how the laser, when it propagates, creates this wake field here. So it pushes out the electron, it creates this cavity, but also it pushes the electron radially here, and you can see the form of the cavity. It's very interesting to see the dynamic of the laser pulse that is compressed in time and in space in order to increase the excitation of the wake field. In 2004, we, for the first time, demonstrated the possibility to produce a quasi-monoenergetic electron beam. At this time, the electron beam was not so stable, so we had a lot of pressure from CERN, from accelerator community, in order to demonstrate the possibility to have a stable electron beam. So this is what drive us to consider a different scheme in order to control the injection and to produce a reliable accelerator. So the first concept that I will explain you is the injector. So this is a picture of the principle of the injector in which this is the density profile that we are using. We have 2 parts, 1 part at high density and 1 part at low density. Why this? Because when the laser is propagating in the high density region, it excites a plasma wave, okay? The electrons are not trapped. When the laser goes suddenly in the transition where the density decreases, as I told you before, the wavelength of the plasma wave, the size of the bubble, is increased because of the reduction of the density. And because of that, the electrons that were located here, now they are inside the bubble where the electric field is very important and is accelerating, as you can see in this red part. So these electrons are injected very locally in the space, and they can be accelerated. And this is what's happened in our accelerator. So this is the principle, and these are the experimental results. It's very easy to achieve. You have a gas target here, and you put on this gas target an obstacle in order to reach this density transition. So these are simulations of the flow, And these are the experimental data, where you can see here the beam that is very stable at 250 MeV and is performed within 1 millimeter distance. And these are the parameters of the beam that we can achieve today with a 1 joule laser. What is very interesting is that you can control the parameter of the electron beam, and to do this, you need just to change the position of the blade. When you change the position of the blade, you change the length of your accelerator. It means that you change the electron energy that you can produce. So this is what we did. You can see how you can control nicely the electron energy from 250 MeV to 50 MeV just by changing the position of the blade. So this is a very nice instrument because you don't have to redesign your accelerator. You just need to move one thing that is the obstacle here. The second concept is the booster. So how we can increase the electron energy. So in our community, what we did in the past is that you consider different stages in which you accelerate in one stage, then after you transport the beam in the second stage, and so on. But this is very difficult to achieve. That's why we propose another idea, which is called the booster. So in this plasma accelerator, if you remember correctly, you have this bubble in which you have, in the left part, in red, the accelerating field, and in green, the decelerating field. When the electrons are injected, they are accelerated until they reach the center of the bubble where the electric field sign change. Okay, so what you have to do now to overcome this limitation is to develop a new concept that is called the booster. This is the density that we are using. It's two-step density, low-density region and high-density region. So it's the opposite that in the injector scheme. Okay, so this is the principle. You have your bubble, you have the electrons that have been injected, they are accelerated, and then suddenly, when they reach the center of the bubble, where they are supposed to be dephased, decelerated, you increase the density. What's happened in this case? Because, as I told you, the size of the bubble is reduced when the density is increasing, these electrons, they are dephased, and now they are not anymore in the center of the bubble, but at the back of the bubble, where the electric field is very important. So this electric field now can accelerate again the electrons. So this is a very simple concept that we demonstrated experimentally, and we even do more than that. We manipulate the two concepts, the injector and the booster, in this experiment, and I show you the result. So this is the experimental setup. You have a gas target, you have the injector that is represented here, and you have the booster that is represented here, which is a very small device, which is a pin with a hole, and we inject the gas in order to have the density increase. The results are the following. This is the electron beam without the density increase. And when you increase the density here in the second part of the accelerator, you can see how you can increase the electron energy by increasing the value of the density. Now I will introduce a last concept which allows to improve one of the properties of the electron beam. So this is called the plasma lens. And it relies again on the use of a density profile that is represented here with two parts, one at high density, a vacuum between, and part at a low density. So this is very important because there is one property in the electron beam which is called the emittance, which is given by this relation. In our case, the emittance depends on the size of the electron beam, which is extremely small, it's 1 micron, but the divergence is quite large, few millirad. So for some application, it's important to reduce the divergence of the electron beam. Especially important if you want to use this electron beam to build what we call the free electron laser. So we developed this concept, which is that I'm going to explain you. In the first part, you have your accelerator. Okay, so the electron is produced, and then after it reached the end of the target here, there is no force anymore, so the electron beam will diverge naturally. The laser beam will diverge also, And then after you put a very low density target here, in which you will create a radial electric field. You remember with the wake field, you can create a radial field. And this radial field can reduce the divergence of the electron beam as indicated here. So this is the principle of the experiment. You have the two gas targets. We measure the density profile. And here you can see the principle of the experiment. The results are here. This is the electron beam energy distribution in the horizontal direction. And this is the divergence of the electron beam. As soon as you put the second gas target, you can see the effect, which is a pinch. The transverse size of the electron beam is reduced by a factor of 3. So this is a very important result for us. I'm going now to discuss during the last 10 minutes about application. So why this laser plasma accelerator are of interest in the near future? I'm not discussing about long-term future application, but in the near future. So we have developed this last 15 years a different method to produce X-ray. So I'm not going to report on all the methods. We discovered the nonlinear Thomson scattering with photon at hundreds of EV. In 2004, we demonstrated the betatron radiation source with photon at tens of keV. In 2011, we discovered the Compton scattering source with photon at hundreds of keV. And then we also produce a Bremsstrahlung source that delivers photon in the MeV range. They are very well collimated. They are femtoseconds. The source size is about 1 micron or few micron. And the brightness is about 10 to 20 in synchrotron units. The betatron source relies on the transverse electric field. So you remember the bubble structure. You have a transverse electric field. When the electrons are injected in this bubble structure, they are accelerated, but they also suffer the radial electric field. It means that this electron will start to oscillate during the acceleration. And you know that when you have a charged particle that oscillates, the particle radiated. And this is what we call the betatron radiation. So this is an example of the calculation of the trajectory of the electrons. And from this, we can calculate the X-ray that you can produce. We understand very well this physics now, and we have done many, many theoretical and experimental work on that. But I'm not going to discuss about all the results. I'm pleased to show one, and it was the first contrast, phase contrast X-ray image that has been obtained here at INRS by the group of Jean-Claude Kiefer. And he will discuss and present more this afternoon. So this is an image of a bee, and you can see here the contour of the body, the eyes, and the legs. And this is a single shot. In one shot, you have this image. And it's very stable, and you can see here the result of 13 shots. So it indicates that the source is very stable. That's very important, X-ray phase contrast image, because it can reveal a very small details in an object that has a density that is very similar to the surrounding tissue density. So it's important also for early breast cancer tumor detection. And this is one of the motivation of this research. And Jean-Claude will explain also the motivation for your community. There is another way to produce even more energetic photon, which is called the Compton source. It relies on the collision of the laser pulse here that will encounter the relativistic electron beam. For us, it's very easy because we produce a relativistic electron beam with a laser, so we can take part of the laser in order to collide with the electron beam. When you do this, you have a reflection of the light of this laser, but the reflection is done at another wavelength, which is given by this formula, and it scales with the square of the electron energy. So if you have, for example, 100 MeV electrons, you can easily produce MeV photon. It's a very nice way to produce a very energetic photon. So we did this experiment, very simple experiment. You have the gas target, you produce the electron beam, and then after you put a very thin foils. The laser will be reflected by the foils, and it will interact naturally with the incoming electron beam, and it will produce this X-ray beam. So the results are reported here. This is the beam with different filters, the X-ray beam with different filters from which you can reconstruct the photon energy distribution. So you can see that in this case, you can have photon up to 140 keV. You can produce even more energetic photon. This is what we call the Bremsstrahlung source. In this case, you need to have the relativistic electron beam interacting with IZ materials. In this case, the electron will slow down, they will make collision with IZ materials, and they will produce a photon with energy comparable to the incoming electron beam. So we did this experiment, and we produced the gamma ray beam here. We removed the electron beam because we want to avoid the interaction between the electron beam and the object that we want to radiograph. And this is a sphere with a lot of details in there. And this is the image that we have obtained in 2004. So we improved the quality of the sources. And you can see here the source that we obtained in 2005 and the source that we obtained in 2010. And you can see the details that are inside the spherical object. And this is a movie where you can see the details of the object. So this is a very promising source, and I create a spin-off company in order to scale down the source. And the source is very important, for example, for non-destructive material inspection. For example, if you are interested to see if there are some problems in the tube that are used in the nuclear plants, and you want to inspect if there are some failures, and it can give you a very high resolution image of very dense objects. So this is an example of application. There is another application that we want to stress is the use of the electron beam for radiotherapy. So you know that 95% of radiotherapy is done with X-ray. And this is the isodose representation. It's a calculation in the real case of prostate cancer tumor. So this is the XIMRT. It's the best treatment today for this kind of cancer tumor. And this is the cancer tumor. And you irradiate the patient with seven field irradiation. You can see here the path of the beam. If you consider very energetic electron at 250 MeV, this is the result of the calculation. And you can see the reduction of the dose in the safe tissue around the tumor. So we have shown in this publication that you can improve the cancer treatment by about 20% by reducing the dose in the safe tissue surrounding the tumor. So this is a very exciting application that we are pushing right now. It's possible, and we are considering today, the use of this electron beam in order to produce what we call a compact free electron machine. So you have free electron laser machine. So you know that these machines are very expensive. There are few in the world. The cost is about 1 billion of euro. And this machine rely on two things. First, a GeV electron beam, and then second, on an undulator, which is a magnetic structure that have a period. The electron oscillate in the structure, they emit radiation, and this radiation can be increase because the electron beam start to be modulated and to produce more radiation. So this is a scheme that we are using here in the experiment that we are doing in collaboration with Soleil, with Marie-Emmanuelle Coupry at Soleil. So this is a very interesting experiment that we are proceeding. But nevertheless, the size of the undulator that is used today is about hundreds of meters. So we are thinking of also changing not only the size of the accelerator by using a plasma, but also the size of the undulator. So this is a new concept that I proposed 3 years ago, in which we consider a nanowire here. So it's an assembly of wires. The laser pulse go through these wires. It will ionize the wires. It will hit the electrons. And it will produce around each wire a radial electric field. So the electrons, the relativistic electrons that follow the laser pulse, see this electric field, and they wiggle into this apparatus. And we can do a start-to-end simulation and calculate the X-ray beam that you can produce. And these are the results. You can see you can produce a tunable X-ray beam with a brightness that is about 10 to 23 in synchrotron units. And this is a tunable source. You can tune, for example, the photon energy by changing the electron energy or by changing the distance between the different wires. So I arrived to my conclusion. I show you a different concept, the injector, the booster, the focusing, the plasma lens device. And now we can combine all these devices in order to build the accelerator of the future that will be based on the laser. On the laser plasma. So I hope that I convince you that laser plasma accelerators are working today, that we can control, which is something that is very important if you think about this, with a single laser pulse, I show you how we can control in a very accurate way the electron motion to deliver an electron beam with tunable parameter. These beams are very stable. The quality of the beam is very high and the current is very high. I didn't have time to discuss about this, but it's about few kiloamps for each beam. There are a lot of applications, and they are almost there for some of them, for cancer imaging, radiotherapy, and security. And there are, in mid-term application, free electron laser. And of course, this research is very important for the future of high energy physics. And we work with this community since 2010. So I would like to conclude and to acknowledge my very good group. I have the chance to have excellent PhD, postdoc, and researcher in my group. And I would like also to thank the different funding agencies. Without them, we were not able to pursue this research. And I would like to thank you for this kind invitation to present this result. Thanks.